Hi, I'm Jim Ward of the Middle Country Public Library, and I'd like to welcome you to episode 46 in our History Bites series. Today, we will discuss the murder of President John F. Kennedy, who was struck down by an assassin's bullet on November 22, 1963, in Dallas, Texas. By the fall of 1963, President John F. Kennedy and his political advisors were preparing for the next presidential campaign. Although he had not formally announced his candidacy, it was clear that President Kennedy was going to run, and he seemed confident about his chances for re-election. At the end of September, the president traveled west, speaking in 9 different states in less than a week. The trip was meant to put a spotlight on natural resources and conservation efforts, but JFK also used it to sound out themes such as education, national security, and world peace for his run in 1964. A month later, the president addressed Democratic gatherings in Boston and Philadelphia. Then, on November 12th, he held the first important political planning session for the upcoming election year. At the meeting, JFK stressed the importance of winning both Florida and Texas and talked about his plans to visit both states in the next 2 weeks. Mrs. Kennedy would accompany him on the swing through Texas, which would be her first extended public appearance since the loss of their baby Patrick in August. On November 21st, the President and First Lady departed on Air Force One for the 2-day, 5-city tour of Texas. Lee Harvey Oswald, born in New Orleans in 1939, joined the U.S. Marines in 1956. He was discharged in 1959 and 9 days later left for the Soviet Union, where he tried unsuccessfully to become a citizen. He worked in Minsk and married a Soviet woman, and in 1962 was allowed to return to the United States with his wife and infant daughter. In early 1963, he bought a .38 caliber revolver and rifle with a telescopic sight by mail order, and on April 10th in Dallas, he allegedly shot at and missed former U.S. Army General Edwin Walker, a figure known for his right-wing views. Later that month, Oswald went to New Orleans and founded a branch of the Fair Play for Cuba Committee, a pro-Castro organization, and distributed pro-Castro leaflets. In September 1963, he went to Mexico City, where investigators alleged that he attempted to secure a visa to travel to Cuba or return to the USSR. In October, he returned to Dallas and took a job at the Texas School Book Depository. President Kennedy was aware that a feud among party leaders in Texas could jeopardize his chances of carrying the state in 1964, and one of his aims for the trip was to bring Democrats together. He also knew that a relatively small but vocal group of extremists was contributing to the political tensions in Texas and would likely make its presence felt, particularly in Dallas, where U.S. Ambassador to the United Nations, Adlai Stevenson, had been physically attacked a month earlier after making a speech there. Nonetheless, JFK seemed to relish the prospect of leaving Washington, getting out among the people and into the political fray. The first stop was San Antonio. Vice President Lyndon B. Johnson, Governor John B. Connally, and Senator Ralph W. Yarborough led the welcoming party. They accompanied the president to Brooks Air Force Base for the dedication of the Aerospace Medical Health Center. Continuing on to Houston, he addressed the League of United Latin American Citizens and spoke at a testimonial dinner for Congressman Albert Thomas before ending the day in Fort Worth. A light rain was falling on Friday morning, November 22nd, but a crowd of several thousand stood in the parking lot outside the Texas Hotel where the Kennedys had spent the night. A platform was set up, and the president, wearing no protection against the weather, came out to make some brief remarks. Quote, "There are no faint hearts in Fort Worth," he began, "and I appreciate your being here this morning. Mrs. Kennedy is organizing herself. It takes longer, but of course she looks better than we do when she does it." End quote. He went on to talk about the nation's need for being second to none in defense and in space, for continued growth in the economy, and the willingness of citizens of the United States to assume the burdens of leadership. The warmth of the audience response was palpable as the president reached out to shake hands amidst a sea of smiling faces. Back inside the hotel, the president spoke at a breakfast of the Fort Worth Chamber of Commerce, focusing on military preparedness.
I don't think that we are fatigued or tired. We would like to live as we once lived, but history will not permit it. Communist balance of power is still strong. The balance of power is still on the side of freedom. We are still the keystone and the arch of freedom. And I think we'll continue to do as we have done in our past, our duty. And the people of Texas will be in the lead. So I'm glad to come.
The presidential party left the hotel and went by motorcade to Carswell Air Force Base for the 13-minute flight to Dallas. Arriving at Love Field, President and Mrs. Kennedy disembarked and immediately walked toward a fence where a crowd of well-wishers had gathered, and they spent several minutes shaking hands. The First Lady received a bouquet of red roses, which she brought with her to the waiting limousine. Governor John Connally and his wife Nellie were already seated in the open convertible as the Kennedys entered and sat behind them. Since it was no longer raining, the plastic bubble top had been left off. Vice President and Mrs. Johnson occupied another car in the motorcade. The procession left the airport and traveled along a 10-mile route that wound through downtown Dallas on the way to the Trade Mart, where the president was scheduled to speak at a luncheon. Crowds of excited people lined the streets and waved to the Kennedys. The car turned off Main Street at Dealey Plaza around 12:30 p.m. Sitting in a Lincoln convertible, the Kennedys and Connellys waved at the large and enthusiastic crowds gathered along the parade route. As it was passing the Texas School Book Depository, gunfire suddenly reverberated in the plaza. Three shots were fired by Lee Harvey Oswald, who was on the sixth floor of the book depository. Bullets struck the president's neck and head, and he slumped over toward Mrs. Kennedy. The governor was shot in his back. The car sped off to Parkland Memorial Hospital just a few minutes away, but little could be done for the president. A Catholic priest was summoned to administer the last rites, and at 1 p.m., John F. Kennedy was pronounced dead. Though seriously wounded, Governor Connally would recover. As tens of thousands of people greeted President Kennedy in downtown Dallas, Abraham Zapruder filmed two of his employees waiting near a grassy knoll just a block from Jennifer Jr.'s, Zapruder's clothing company. Receptionist Marilyn Sitzman waved to the camera as payroll clerk Beatrice Hester sat with her husband Charles on a nearby bench. Zapruder then climbed atop a concrete abutment and waited. Sitzman supported him in case Zapruder became dizzy. He stood 65 feet from the center of Elm Street. Zapruder filmed the Kennedy limousine after it turned onto Elm Street and captured the entire assassination, the only photographer to do so. He used a Bell & Howell Model 414PD Zoomatic Director Series camera with a Varamet 9 27mm f1.8 zoom lens set for full close-up. Its 8mm Kodachrome 2 color film moved through the camera at an average speed of 18.3 frames per second, as determined by later tests. Zapruder continued filming after the shooting, which took less than 10 seconds. He and Sitzman jumped down and walked into the shelter of a nearby pergola as the Hesters crouched on the grass. Zapruder and Sitzman soon became separated. Reporter Harry McCormick of the Dallas Morning News, having raced from the Dallas Trade Mart where Kennedy was headed, noticed Zapruder in Dealey Plaza and learned what happened. Zapruder would speak only with federal investigators, so McCormick said he would contact Forrest Sorrells, the head of the Dallas Secret Service Office, for him. Dallas Times-Herald reporter Darwin Payne ran to nearby Dealey Plaza after getting word of the shooting. He heard of Zapruder and his film from two of his employees, probably Sitzman and Hester, standing outside the Texas School Book Depository. Payne then went to Zapruder's office across the street for an interview. Payne interviewed Zapruder and tried to get publication rights for the newspaper. McCormick arrived with Sorrells and headed to Zapruder's office. When Payne objected to the competing reporter's exclusive presence, McCormick and Payne were ejected. Zapruder offered to get Sorrells a copy of his film. Not long after shots rang out in Dealey Plaza, CBS was the first to go live with the news at 12:40 p.m. Central Time, beating NBC by less than a minute. By 12:48 p.m., CBS's Walter Cronkite was on camera, followed soon after by NBC and ABC. When reports arrived that Kennedy had died, Cronkite was hesitant to report it to the public until the news was confirmed. Cronkite ultimately announced the news when he was passed the report from Dan Rather, the New Orleans bureau chief, who had been on the ground in Dallas at the time. Cronkite took off his glasses to underscore the seriousness of the moment, creating an image that would stick in the minds of many viewers forever.
From Dallas, Texas, the flash, apparently official, President Kennedy died at 1 p.m. Central Standard Time, 2 o'clock Eastern Standard Time, some 38 minutes ago. Vice President Lyndon Johnson has left the hospital in Dallas, but we do not know to where he has proceeded. Presumably, he will be taking the oath of office shortly and become the 36th President of the United States.
The President's body was brought to Love Field and placed on Air Force One. Before the plane took off, a grim-faced Lyndon B. Johnson stood in the tight, crowded compartment and took the oath of office administered by U.S. District Court Judge Sarah Hughes. The brief ceremony took place at 2:38 p.m. Less than an hour earlier, police had arrested Lee Harvey Oswald, a recently hired employee at the Texas School Book Depository. He was being held for the assassination of President Kennedy and the fatal shooting shortly afterward of patrolman J.D. Tippit on a Dallas street. On November 24th, Oswald was brought to the basement of the Dallas Police Headquarters on his way to a more secure county jail. A crowd of police and press with live television cameras rolling gathered to witness his departure. As Oswald came into the room, Jack Ruby, who operated strip joints and dance halls in Dallas and had minor connections to organized crime, emerged from the crowd and fatally wounded him with a single shot from a concealed .38 caliber revolver. Ruby, who was immediately detained, claimed that rage at Kennedy's murder was the motive for his action. Some called him a hero, but he was nonetheless charged with first-degree murder. That same day, President Kennedy's flag-draped casket was moved from the White House to the Capitol building on a caisson drawn by six gray horses, accompanied by one riderless black horse. At Mrs. Kennedy's request, the cortege and other ceremonial details were modeled on the funeral of Abraham Lincoln. Crowds lined Pennsylvania Avenue and many wept openly as the caisson passed. During the 21 hours that the president's body lay in state in the Capitol Rotunda, about 250,000 people filed by to pay their respects. On Monday, November 25th, 1963, President Kennedy was laid to rest in Arlington National Cemetery. The funeral was attended by heads of state and representatives from more than 100 countries, with untold millions more watching on television. Afterward, at the gravesite, Mrs. Kennedy and her husband's brothers, Robert and Edward, lit an eternal flame. Perhaps the most indelible images of the day were the salute to his father given by little John F. Kennedy Jr., whose third birthday it was, daughter Caroline kneeling next to her mother at the president's bier, and the extraordinary grace and dignity shown by Jacqueline Kennedy. As people throughout the nation and the world struggled to make sense of a senseless act and to articulate their feelings about President Kennedy's life and legacy, many recalled these words from his inaugural address.
All this will not be finished in the first 100 days, nor will it be finished in the first 1,000 days, nor in the life of this administration, nor even perhaps in our lifetime on this planet. But let us begin.
The presidency of JFK continues to influence many generations through his initiatives in civil rights, the arts, volunteerism, space exploration, and technology. I'd like to thank you for joining us for today's episode. Comment below and let us know where you were and what you were doing when you heard of the president's assassination.